So thank you for joining us. It's the October release overview, and Rizzo's going to be talking about client certificate authentication and security realms. So as normal, we'll be doing a release overview, and then also talking about some other issues like path traversal security vulnerability, client certificate validation checks, configuring the HTTP zip compression, JDK 17, some future plans as well. And then, as normal, plenty of time for questions and discussion afterwards. So if you guys do have any sort of issues or problems that we may be able to help with, then we'll be happy to talk about it. If it's something more like a bug or something like that, then GitHub's probably the best place to go. But I hope you enjoy. If you ask any questions, I will try and pose them to Rudy, because he might not be able to see them as he's talking. Either when there's a gap or after he's finished speaking. And we should have a poll as well about halfway through. So just keep your eyes out for that. Well, thank you very much. Over to you.
Yep. Thank you, Jaden. So yes, it's the release webinar of October. So I will discuss a few functionalities that we have released in September and October. And since we have worked the last few months on a few additions on the client certificate authentication and features, then I thought it was a good idea to give you an overview of that functionality, what client certificate authentication is, how you can use it, and what we can offer within Payara. But first, have a look at the new functionality, the main functionality released in September. For the community release, that was the release number 5.2021.7. And yeah, probably you saw it in the announcements that we have fixed there an important security vulnerability when your application is deployed on the root, so without any context root name. But more on that in a minute, so I'll go a bit deeper on it. And of course, if possible, switch as soon as possible to this version or the version that we released last week, the October one. As mentioned, we did some work around client certificate. So parts of it was done in July. The second part here was in September with a custom validations, an SPI, so that you as developer can add some custom checks on that client certificate or any kind of other check that you want to add on top of that client certificate. And then as part of micro profile, we added support for the proxy. So if you are using a REST client in a programmatic way, you have now a method to specify proxy information as well as the location and password information that you want to pass on to the proxy. Especially important if you go outside your environment to an external endpoint. The October one announced last week, there was another addition on the client certificate ones, which I go more in detail in the second half. But we also made it possible to configure the details of the HTTP zip compression, which we have available. So I'll show it to you in a small demo, how you can configure that and when it can be important that you activate that compression or change the compression level, etc. Those are only the highlights of the community release. The main features and things, there are smaller additions. There are also various fixes. So have a look at the release notes on our Payara documentation site to read all about the details that are available in these two versions, in those two releases. We have also an enterprise release every month, so also in September and October. The September one, the 5.31, we have the same topics as in the community one, so that security vulnerability, the client certificates, and the proxy support. And with the October one, the 5.32, we have added the upgrade to Hazelcast 4. It's already available in community, but it's now available in enterprise also, but I talk more about the the reason why it was delayed and what you need to take care of if you switch from an older version to this newer version. For our customers, they can have the look at the full release notes on our customer hub also, the knowledge base area where they can also find, besides the release notes, all the best practices and some articles around the configuration and more deep knowledge around Payara. So in the September release, that was an important thing there, of course, at the security vulnerability. You have the CVE number there noted down. And when your application is deployed on the root, then it is possible that a user can read some information from within your application, like reading files within your webinf folder, which should not be accessible. So that's the issue, that's the security vulnerability. Because in that webinf directory, some files could contain some sensitive information which should not be allowed to read by anyone outside of your organization. So you have there the URL that you can use if your application is deployed on the root of your server, of your Payara Micro is also affected. Then you can see, if, for instance, the WebXML file, if you have one, if the WebXML file is accessible through the browser by using that ./webinf/webxml URL. So it's a rather high risk because you can read part of the configuration, or someone can read part of the configuration. So that also meant that we have sent information to our customers about this. They are notified individually, and we help them to migrate, to help them find a solution for this issue. So that's one of the benefits that Payara Enterprise customers has. I also want to mention here that it's not a full path reversal, because path traversal most of the time means that anyone can read the entire contents of the server, so it can read any kind of file. So this is not the case. It's only within the application. That's not outside of your application. But nonetheless, if you're running on your application root, we highly recommend that you upgrade your environment to this or the October release, the latest release, of course. Then a few words around that Hazelcast 4, which is now in enterprise. It was already in community. We started in the first release of this year, that was February, where we upgraded to 4.0. But there were, in some situations, some issues with Hazelcast. So if you are using the cache solution, then in certain configurations, then there were some issues. So all of them were solved in the 2021.5 release of the Payara community. And by that time, we also updated to the Hazelcast 4.2. So this is also a nice example of the differences between community and enterprise. Community, we do some things gradually. It might be the case that it's not 100% functional, like in this case with the Hazelcast 4 upgrade. So after everything is ready for the larger things, then we port all those changes to enterprise, and we do some extensive testing. In this case, it was about a month of testing that we did to see if anything is breaking with Hazelcast 4 in enterprise. With all the user scenarios we had, it's about 15 or 17 user scenarios. Because as you know, Hazelcast is a very important component within Payara. It's not used only for caching, but also for our clustering solution. Several functionalities of Payara depend on Hazelcast. So that's the reason why we took a large amount of time to test it, of course, extensively within enterprise. Nonetheless, we have tested it, there are still some breaking changes that we cannot avoid. because they are located within Hazelcast. For instance, if you are interacting directly with Hazelcast classes, for instance, within a CDI bean, you can inject a Hazelcast instance where you can then access the maps, the events, basically all functionality of Hazelcast itself. Since Hazelcast changed some classes, changed some methods, has changed some functionality of the framework itself, we cannot avoid, of course, that you have some changes there also within PyAra. Another issue that you might have is that when you are doing rolling upgrades, and some users are running, for instance, PyAra Micro in a cluster and do a rolling upgrade. So taking one instance down of PyAra Micro and starting up a new version, so that you always have all the data available in the in-memory the data grid of Hazelcast, so that's, that you don't lose that, which is not possible now. If you do this upgrade from Hazelcast 3.12, which was the previous version, to 4.2 here now, because Hazelcast changed some things in the protocol between the communication between the different parts of the cluster. So that means that you cannot have a cluster comprised of Hazelcast 3 and Hazelcast 4 members. So that rolling upgrade is also not possible here if you do the upgrade of PyAra micro instances, for example. Then the possibility to configure the zip compression within the server. So the compression itself is already available from day one within PyAra. So it was always there that you could activate an option so that the response is compressed and sent in a compressed format to the client. And most of the time, it's most useful if you have bandwidth issues. So if you're sending a lot of information back to the client, and if for some reason the bandwidth is limited, then this compression can be a solution. Be also aware that, of course, that compression itself takes some additional time, so it affects the performance of your server. So the time to generate such a request takes a bit longer, but the overall experience for your client can be better because the data, less data is coming in. So that if that is a limiting factor, that means that the overall experience can be better for your client. You can activate it in the protocol at that zip compression fact, the feature, and now with this release, the October release, you also have control about the level and the strategy, so they are configurable. So the deflator algorithm, which is also known as that gzip compression, which is from within the JDK itself, that has two options that can be configured at the level of compression between 1 and 9. One is no or very limited amount of compression. 9 is a maximum. Of course, again, if you do more compression, it means you are spending more time or CPU cycles in creating that high compression level of 9 there. And by default, the value is 6. So if you don't specify it, it is 6 just as before, without, if you could not change the level and the strategy before this release. Also, the strategies can be changed. Have a look at the internet where it is described, how you can define the strategy, what the differences are between, for instance, the filtering and the Huffman algorithm. And again, that can have some impact on size and on performance. So I would suggest if you have a use case for that compression and that you maybe play around with those level and strategy to find out what the optimal values for your environment are, because that also depends on the use cases, which responses you are generating, etc. I can show you that that example. So I'm running here IR environment on JDK 8. So, and then the version of IR is that latest one, is the 21.8. So that's the October release of last week. I have already deployed an application, but that's for that client certificate one. But you also have, of course, that welcome page, the index page, which you can look at. So if you just request that page, then you see that the size of that page is about 4,500 bytes long. That's without any kind of compression. I have activated the compression all also. So that means if I ask the compressed format, so I put in the request header that that zip is allowed. So then the server will choose that one. And with this very complex command that I just Googled around, because I'm not that wizard that knows all those things, you can find out the size of that compressed response. And you see, instead of 4,500, it's only 1,822 bytes long. So that means a considerable reduction in size. We can change at the compression level. It's now at standard. It's level 6. Yes, it's min. So the default is 6. So if I change that to 2, for instance, this is it's very low. So it's not that much compression. If I ask the size again, you see now that it is a bit more larger than before. So indeed, it probably took a bit less of time, but of course you cannot see that here because it's only a small difference and not that long response. But you see that the size is a bit larger than with the default compression of 6. If we change it to 9, that's the maximum one, and we ask the compression again, we see that we only gained 2 bytes. So 9 is not that much better than 6. So the optimal at the default, but again, that depends. At the default is 6, which is taken from the JDK implementation. So how you so all this information, we have a blog. We have mentioned that all in the blog that we have released earlier this week, how you can configure it and all the details of this compression option that you have now. So already a word on the client certificate validation that we added in September and October. And so client certificates can be used as authentication mechanism, just as you can use usernames and passwords for users, but that client certificate then is of course not, or it can be used, but mainly not for for users, but when you have a other process that connects to the server and exchange data, then because it's a non-interactive environment, instead of using a password, then this client certificate is it's a much better solution and is also a very secure one. By default, this certificate still needs to be in the key store. That's not changed since before this release with older versions. But we have now added a SPI so that you can add some validation, and basically any kind of validation that can be defined by the developer. So every time such a client certificate protected request comes in, you can have a custom piece of code that is executed. It just needs to implement this client certificate validator interface, which has one method, is valid. I'll show it to you in the second part of the demo. And there you can perform any additional check on the certificate. For instance, what you can do is implement what's called the Online Certificate Status Protocol, and the OCSP, which is supported by many of those certificate authorities which provide you with such client certificates. And that OCSP can be used to online revoke your client certificate. So if you say, for whatever reason, I do not trust that certain certificate anymore, because I have the impression that it is compromised, that someone has taken control over it other than the intended party, then you can, for instance, revoke it there. And then with this additional check that you implement here, then you can immediately also reject that request, which has that client certificate as part of it. The implementation of that OSCSP is there shown in the link. So we have here, so anyone can have a look here. So that's the GitHub page. There is some documentation there. There is the code also available that describes how you can implement it. I can go quickly over that. It's here. So as I said, interface client certificate validator and is valid, which receives, for example, that client certificate in its entirety, but also some parts of it, like the principal and the subject of that client certificate. You need to have the certificate of the issuer for that, because that contains, for example, that OCSP endpoint that you need to call. But as you can see, that's not that much code, because most of the code is just available within the JDK itself and the JVM code itself. And this OCSP class is available within JDK 8 and 11. And you have a check method which can check a certain, in this case, our client certificate that we received and the issuer certificate that we have looked up from the key store that we have specified, and then some information which is derived from that key. You get back a revocation status if it's the certificate is still accepted and still good to go, or that it is revoked or unknown when, for instance, the endpoint was not accessible. The reason this is not included within Payara server itself is because you need some kind of caching mechanism, and that depends, of course, from in most cases, from application to application, how you want to cache this. You need to cache this for the simple reason, because if you are using such client certificates, those certificates are added or required for each request, and because it is not it's kind of stateless, which means that this check is performed many times, and that means that it will impact the performance, of course. So the recommendation is that you, of course, cache this for few hours a day, whatever your time window is, and that you store the result for the OCSP check in some kind of caching mechanism which suits you best for your environment. But the code is there. So one of the more difficult pieces are already there, so that you know how you can implement the OSCSP check yourself, and then you only need to integrate it for your situation. JDK 17. Why JDK 17? It was not on the overview of new functionality which is supported in community and enterprise, because it's not yet final. So we hope that we can have fully JDK supported versions in November. Can be December also, of course. But we have already partial support in Payara Micro. So you can already use Payara Micro on JDK 17. JDK 17, as you know, it's the current LTS version and the long-term supported version. And in contrast with JDK 16, for instance, and 18, which has to come, it is longer support than 6 months. Those interim versions, or how should I call them, you normally even can only are only allowed to use them for 6 months. But now with those LTS versions at the implementers like Azul, they support it for on average 7 years. And that means that you have every 3 months fixes some security updates, etc. But the basic functionality, the basic language features, all the parameters, etc., stay constant during all those years, which means it is, of course, a good candidate for an enterprise environment like you are running with Payara. And that's also the case then that we are supporting it with Payara 5 also. So the Payara 5 binaries will, the same binary will run on JDK 8, JDK 11, and JDK 17. For our October release, Payara Micro can already start on JDK 17, but there was at that moment that we made a cutoff for the release, there were still some issues with Eclipse Link and some security-related issues, which are already fixed for the moment, but of course they are not available yet in a final release. And as I mentioned, hopefully in November it will be the case that we can announce fully support for JDK 17. You may ask yourself, why should I switch to JDK 17? Is there any reason? Is there any need? Well, there are several of them. One of the good things, as I mentioned, even if your application is compiled, your web app is compiled for JDK 8 or 11, you can run it on also on JDK 17. So there is, in that sense, fully backwards compatible. And you can benefit from the performance and the garbage collection improvements that they have done. So I have done some testing, although it's not fully scientific, of course, but it shows clearly that there are so the same application running on JDK 11 and JDK 17, and that the JDK 17 one runs up to 20% faster. And of course, depending on the situation and how much memory you assign it, etc. But that means that, of course, that 20% can be a very very good reason to consider the switch to JDK 17. But you can also use the JDK 17 features already, the record, the switch expression, text blocks, etc. Even if they are not known by Jakarta 8 or 9, you can use them. I'm giving a presentation on that on the Jakarta One Live beginning of December, but I can already show you quickly what that means. I need to switch that window here. So I have an application here, which is based on Jakarta EE web. So that's 8, so that's an older one, but no problem with that. You can still say that the compiler target and the source are 17. The only thing that you need to make sure is that the Maven War plugin, that you put a very recent version, because one of the things which they have done in JDK 16 and 17 is, again, stricter encapsulation. So some classes and packages are no longer accessible by default. So this version works around that problem. Not going to the entire application, the detail and all and all the explanations, that's for that presentation in a month. But I have here, for instance, an endpoint, a YaxRes endpoint, which produces JSON, but it returns a list of the record here. So the new construct of JDK 15, I think it was introduced. The only thing that I need to know and that I need to change for the moment is that the JSONB specification requires really a method called get or is. So that means that I have to use something like get name and get continent name as my property names for my record and not just name and continent name. But other than that, I can use it already. For example, I have here Java 17 in this window. So this is my the September release of the JDK 17 there. So it's not the one of this month, the update. I can start a Payara Micro. I sign it another port because by default that I have still that Payara server running there. And I have here that WAR file that was compiled with JDK 17. It starts up. There is no issue. You see the endpoints just as in other cases. And if I query that endpoint, which was in the theme of the Olympic Games, for instance, all the countries of Europe, and the application also has something around the colors, then you can see that I get a JSON error back based on that record, and the Java 17 record, even with Jakarta EE8 applications. So I have that name and continent name elements here all the time repeated in that JSON array. So more on that and what other goodies there are on JDK 17, you can tune in for that presentation then. So our question is then now, do you have already plans for moving to JDK 17? So we have created a little poll for that. So Jaden can pull that up, that question, there it is. So the title is wrong, but anyway, when do you plan to use JDK 17? So I want to use it today. We have already some questions that people want to use it and are waiting until we release the full support for JDK 17. That's one option. Other option is that you plan it between 6 months or within a year. And within those two, you also have the release of Jakarta EE10, which will have sufficient support for JDK 17. So maybe you're waiting for that. And then that means that you are waiting for Payara 6, which will have support for Jakarta EE10 and JDK 17, of course, or you don't know it yet. So I think, Jaden, do we have enough responses?
Yep, we have 83%.
And what's the outcome?
If I press end poll, will it show it?
I do a screenshot just in case it gets rid of it. Okay, let's have a look.
So there is a mixture between, I don't know yet, and between 6 months and a year and Jakarta E10. So there is no clear indication of what you think that you want to use JDK 17 for. But a good thing is that people at least are planning for it within 6 months or a year. So also the switch from JDK 11 to 17 will be a much easier one than 8 to 11. So that's, of course, also a good thing. Okay, so
we just had a question just on that subject. Yeah, okay. Anbu just asks, will Payara 6 drop support for Java 8?
Yes. Payara 6, well, I say yes, but the plan is that it drops support. But the idea is that Payara 6 is JDK 11 and JDK 17 only.
That's Payara Community, but Payara Enterprise will have support.
Payara Enterprise might have support for JDK 8, yes. So next, the second part, first maybe future releases beside the JDK 17. We are also planning for December another Payara 6 version and the Alpha 2, because by then MicroProfile 5 should be out, which is the Jakarta namespace version of MicroProfile 4.1. So then again, we can have a Payara version, a Payara 6 version with the entire feature set, because we have now Payara 6 Alpha 1 is a reduced one because MicroProfile was not available in the Jakarta namespace. So that's the plan for November and December. And then to our monthly team, the client certificates authentication, and what is it? You can define it as a Realm, the classic Realm, but also as annotation, so more the modern way, let's say. And what features do we have, and how does that custom validation fits in that I showed already? And then a small demo to show you how you can have more control of which certificates are accepted and which not. So in brief, this is a graph indicating how that works. For those who are not familiar with the client certificate, it's of course a very simplified one because there are a lot more things going on. But yeah, first of all, the client connects to the server, but that's also using the HTTPS endpoint. So it is using the TLS algorithms and protocols, because client certificate is always on top of a secure connection. So that's also the reason why it's called a mutual secure authentication, because not only the server needs to provide the certificate, so needs to prove that it is actually the server that is responding to the client and not some man in the middle, but also that the client needs to provide a certificate to the server to prove the identity of the client, and that also cannot be faked because the client has the private key of that certificate. And the server can verify with the certificate authority of that certificate that it receives from the client is indeed valid. So as I mentioned, when the client is also a process, as you show there, it's a computer, so it's not a user. It's most of the time a process which uses that client certificate that is a secure option to talk to the server. Another option, which is more recently added to the possibilities, is of course using the JWT tokens, JWT tokens, to provide the identity. But there is the case that, again, the client creates and owns it, and this the server in that case only has the public key. And so it's not there, it's not initiated by the server in most cases, but initiated by the client. How can you configure it within Payara server? That's there is the let's say the official Jakarta EE way, where you define in the WebXML file a element is called login config, where you define client cert as authentication method. At that point, the client certificate will be required for all secured endpoints. But as you know, there is also Jakarta EE security, which wants to make some security related aspects easier. And the client certificate is not yet part of Jakarta EE yet, but we have already created, I think more than a year ago, even almost two years ago, actually two annotations which are identical then to that WebXML login config element configuration, but based on that Jakarta EE security one. There is a possibility that it will end up in Jakarta EE 10, which comes out beginning of next year, or it might be skipped and then it will be in 11 probably. And with those two annotations, you say that a certain authentication mechanism compatible with that certificates is used, and you have that identity store which by default validates the client certificate. Besides this mechanism, you also need to define, of course, which endpoints are secured and which roles you need for those secure endpoints, and that means that you can define it within WebXML. That's more or less the older way, and the newer way is the at roles allowed annotation, which you can put on a servlet, for instance, or a YaxRS resource. And then security has two parts, as you know, the authentication part that identifies if the credentials are correct, and then the authorization which defines which permissions the user has, the authenticated user has. So the authentication part is what we have now updated in the last few months. We have added a few additional features. You still have to place that client certificate within the key store. That is not changed, but from the July release, you have the option now, and it's the preferred one even, to not use the Payara key store to store that client certificate in, because when you upgrade your server, then of course that Payara key store is replaced with the new one. So that means that you have lost that client key certificate uploads in the in that key store. So therefore you have those custom ones that you can just link with the configuration that can be used by Payara, which is then of course the preferred one because it's much easier for an upgrade. You have now the additions that we did the last 2 months, the additional checks through that validator, you have that client certificate validator interface, which is the possibility to have it in the Jakarta EE way, as I named it in the previous slides, when you are using WebXML and that login config element. If you are using those identity stores with Jakarta EE security one, then you can just create a custom identity store that can be also picked up during the authentication, and then you can write any additional checks within that custom identity store, of course. But now you have, with that client certificate validator, the same possibilities also to have it within the classic Jakarta EE way. And that authorization part, we added some functionality there also, I think 2 years ago, where you can base the groups and roles of the accepted client certificate on the subject or the principal name or the distinguished name parts of that subject, so that you have much more flexibility in defining the groups and roles for authorization. So let's go to the last demo. I see a few new questions. Is there anything related to this client certificate, Jaden?
There's two questions. I don't know if you want to wait for later. One is, what is the status of MicroProfile LRA in Payara?
Okay, I can answer that later. Because...
Okay. And then the other one is more related to the other topic, but will Payara 6 support both Jakarta EE 9.1 and Jakarta EE 10?
The idea is that it only supports EE 10.
Okay.
Because 9.0 and 9.1 is just basically a is the same as Jakarta EE8 functional wise. It's only a difference in the Jakarta namespace and the JDK 11 possibility for certifications. But real functionality, new features are now in EE10. So that's the reason why we think that people then either choose Payara 6 for Jakarta EE10. Or still use Payara 5, and we have that transformer that can automatically change the namespaces when you deploy your applications from the Jakarta namespace to the Java X namespace. So even today already, you can run Jakarta EE9 and 9.1 applications on Payara 5. So that's the reason why we are planning to have only EE10 support. This was for my test, so I'm going to hide it because then you see what I want to do. This is an application, as I mentioned, for that client certificate, that login config here with that auth method, that client cert. As I mentioned, you can use also that annotation. You need to specify which endpoints are secure. So here we say everything within it's not directory, but in the path fragment secure is needs to have the my role before they can have access. And then the authorization here is still using the full name. So this is the name which I'm using within the two client certificates that I created. So I created two certificates with a different name, but they both have access to that my role. So they both have access to, in theory, this hello servlet, which is in that secure part, which does nothing else than just returning the name. But if it returns the name, then you know that the entire client certificate was set up correctly and that the custom validation is working, because again, I have here a implementation on that client certificate validator that is valid method. And it says here, just bluntly, if the certificate contains as name Rudy1, then it is allowed. So that means only one of the two certificates is allowed and the second one is rejected. Although it is a valid certificate and the certificate is placed in the key store. As you have maybe seen on the slides, this is an interface. It's a typical SPI, so it's loaded via the service loader mechanism. So you need to define a within the file of the with the name of the interface in the MetaInf services where you place the class name of your implementation, which I showed you here in a moment. So that's the application, that's my endpoint. And then I have here a test application, and because I wanted to do it in a semi-automated way, doing some hacks. So because I'm using a custom SSL socket factory, because I'm using self-signed certificates, which are by default not allowed, etc. So, but it works also, of course, otherwise. Point is, I'm first using that certificate when to call that endpoint here. Call here that added so the secure endpoint, that secure hello servlet, and I check if there is a response, yes or no, or that there was an error. And I do that twice, as mentioned, first with the certificate one, which is accepted, and then the certificate two, which is a valid one, also in this key store, but is rejected by our custom validation. Same validation that is used to define that OCSP one. So certificate one is all fine, all accepted, endpoint returned the expected result. Certificate two resulted in 401, which means that the security, there was a security issue that it was rejected. So that is an example of how you can use the custom validation. Again, here you have the complete freedom as a developer what you want to do with those custom checks. You can check, for instance, if that name is within the database, for instance, if you don't want to use OSCSP or whatever, you can do whatever you like, and you can make it dynamic. That's the whole point about this edition. So that's about the presentation and the demos itself. So replying to that question, what's about microprofile LRA? Well, we have a microprofile LRA implementation, a proof of concept, so that is available. But we have not seen that much interest in it. So that's the reason why we did not work on it. So if there seems to be more and more interest in that one, then we can finalize that one, and we can probably release that as some kind of add-on to the current code base. The idea is that the Hazelcast, that internal Hazelcast that we have, is used to keep track of all the transactions, if you call them like that, all the transactions which are going in LRA within all the parts, etc. So that is the ID. Any other questions we did not touch, or anything in general?
No. Further questions in the Q&A section. No further questions in the chat. If you do have any further questions, now is the time. I'm also going to just drop in the survey link as well. We're currently running a survey, so if you take part, you have a very good chance of winning a $25 Amazon gift voucher. But also, you'll be helping improve
Power as well, as all feedback is really useful for us. So I'll just put that link in the chat.
We have maybe also the announcement that we have that we are a forum now. We have a new, brand new, shiny environment for discussions at forum.payara.fish, where you can ask your questions and we have now full control, so we can do it in a moderated way. So it is much better than the previous one, which we were using.
Yes, definitely. So please go check it out. And let us know what you think. There's discussions in there already, we also make announcements there as well. So if you want somewhere where doesn't have all the noise of social media, then it's a good place to go to see what people are doing and ask any questions you might have as well.
Announcements, other announcements of other webinars, meetups that we are doing. So in November, we have two other confirmed presentations. One is with Hazelcast, about using Hazelcast SQL and how you can combine that, for instance, with Payara Micro. And with Hazelcast SQL, you can query your cache in a much more performant way than otherwise. So tune in with Nicholas Frankel if you're interested in that. I think it will appear on the meetup by the end of this week. And then we also have a webinar with Gelastic, which is about automatic clustering of Payara in the cloud, especially on the Gelastic platform. And then we are also present on several conferences, EclipseCon one, which is in progress now. So thank you for watching this release webinar and not one of the probably very interesting EclipseCon presentations, but tomorrow I'm giving there my presentation on EclipseCon. Next week, we also have DevOps UK, a presentation. We have JFAL, which is an in-person one, and it is sold out. So for those, if there are from the Netherlands, if you don't have a ticket, sorry, you can't fit in anymore. And then we have beginning December, Jakarta One Live, which I mentioned for the JDK 17 and Jakarta EE.
Okay, fantastic.
Any burning last minute questions?
Thank you very much, Martin. Do try. No, I think we're good. So if anything does come to mind, please just send us a message through the website, through the forum, through Twitter, or other social media, and we'll get back to you. Keep a look on our meetup page as well. As Rudy says, we're always adding more and more events. Thank you very much, Ambi.
Yep, thank you, and enjoy the rest of the day and the week.
Cheers. Thank you very much.
Bye.